It's not Mother's Day. But I was contemplating, thinking, as I was meditating with the Lord, about the significance of a mother. And one thing men have never been, they've never been women and never been mothers. And even when men raise their children by themselves, they still are not mothers. They are fathers. And God, by his grace, helps them. And that applies to the same to women who raise their children alone. God helps us. In other words, God is not limited, that God can meet every need according to his scripture, no matter what. And but there is something unique about a mother, that she possesses passions and feelings and wisdom that is given to them. No matter where you go, if you find a mother that truly loves their children, and I say truly loves their children, love your children is love your children, but then when I say truly, it just extends to the fact you're incorporating the word of God in that love, so that the basis of your love springs from the word of God, not just from history of what you've observed or maybe something that you read somewhere else. Parenting through the word of God is quite rich and wonderful, and yet at the same time, we cannot deny the fact that God has instilled in the mothers of the world this inherent passion to love their children. You see it not only within the human experience, you see it in the animal kingdom, the nurturing aspect of mothers. And then there are some mothers who take flight and the father does the rest of the job. However, we are not animals per se. What I'm just saying is that there's a uniqueness to a mother who's recognizing that she has a need and a passion to have that need fulfilled and having to turn to God to get it. And we see it with Hannah in scripture. She wanted something from God, and God wanted something from and through her. So both desired to have something, and God met, fulfill his need by meeting her need. And here came the prophet Samuel. But it was the stirring of a mother's heart to go beyond her husband's goodness towards her and press on to God, to press in to God, not having the ceiling of the father saying, but am I not worth more than 10 sons to you? Which is wonderful because you see how he was treating her and how he loved her. And yet that was not enough. There was not enough stirring in a mother's heart when a father had come to a conclusion. You follow me so far? I'm not speaking wrong against her husband, but to the deepness of the longing of the mother, that she wanted something from God. And so Hannah pressed on, and we're gonna look at another mother. God has uniquely designed women to be women. And I know that's a revelation, but he has uniquely designed them. And it's something about that aspect that the Lord deems beautiful. And that's why you find many women carrying the passion to follow Jesus. The men were there, but the women were there too. And the scripture lists them by name. And even on Paul's team, all the women that were ministers unto him and ministers of the Lord, and for Phoebe and all the ladies that are listed, the Lord has included them, so much so under the new covenant. We find that there's neither male nor female in priority based on gender. But in combination, females bring something to the table, males bring something to the table, and we rejoice in that. But just the fact that there's neither male nor female, that is a shocking revelation to a culture who did not really embrace or understand that when it was first being presented. Here we're going to look at not only a mother, we're going to look at a Gentile mother. And as you know, just historically, the Gentiles were not in the under the Old Covenant. And the Old Covenant was to Israel. And yet it had its promises linking to Abraham. Most of the Jews at that time didn't really grasp the revelation that the seed of Abraham would include Gentile women too and Gentile men too. And while that separation was necessary for a moment to develop a people that will carry the gospel, it is also important to see God's eternal plan to include the whole world in his plan. And so thus the apostle makes the declaration, there's neither Jew nor Gentile, male nor female, bond nor free. Nothing carries in its class any priority that overrides faith in Jesus Christ. And it's that faith that we know that is the thing that pleases God, not only then, but now. We know that even during prior to the Old Covenant, we saw the demonstration of faith. By faith, Noah moved. Noah was not under the Old Covenant. Abraham, by faith, offered Isaac, not under the Old Covenant, but they had their own covenants between them and God. Abraham and his seed first. And that seed, as we have learned, was who? That seed was Jesus. And so now we have a woman who is seeking and searching. So let's just take a dive into this together. And as we've been talking on last Sunday, we were talking about the covenant of mercy, the covenant of mercy. And the beauty of the covenant of mercy is that, as mentioned Sunday, that everyone has experienced and everyone needs it. Am I right? And so we're going to look together at Matthew 15 and verse 21. Let's begin there. Matthew 15 and 21. Then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. Now, just this pause here. This is another time where Jesus is leaving the country, and he's actually going to what is present-day Lebanon and to a city of Gentiles. Now, just before we begin going into this, the scripture helps us see a fuller picture when we look at two scriptures that are talking about the same thing. So we'll do that, but let's just continue in this verse. So he go to a foreign country. Now, when I say foreign, meaning it's an area that's a Gentile rule. That's what it is. It is a district. It's not beyond Romans' reach, but it is a Gentile area. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried out to him. She cried out to him. We could casually look at cried out to him, but if, let's say if you got a baby that's real hungry, what do they typically do? They do a? Do they say, could you just pass me a Kleenex and dab their eyes? They will wail, won't they? And it's amazing. They'll keep crying until they're fed. And we look at that in this context that there was a woman of Canaan now, and that came from that region. Now Jesus has come into her region. She's not going over to Jerusalem. Jesus is coming to her. You may often wonder, you know, why Jesus must needs go through Samaria. Because there's a woman in Samaria that Jesus doesn't key his disciples into what his mission was. And this well was there, it was Jacob's well. And Jesus sat there, and then came a woman of Samaria. Samaritans were Jews and Gentiles who had, you know, joined together in marriage. And so the Jews, some of those Jews historically didn't care for the Samaritans because they just didn't say, they just, you know, it's us and them. But instead, we see Jesus going to Samaria because there was a woman there. And he sat on the well and he waited for her. It's amazing. He waited for her. Now, it wasn't that he wasn't weary from the journey. He was weary for the journey, but he sat down and he waited. And then came a woman of Samaria. And she was bearing what I call her buckets or her water pots. And you know this story well, but we just see this insight into the scripture where Jesus, the woman says to him after he just asked her, give me some water. It's amazing the grievance that you may have from past encounters can transfer into new encounters so that you treat the person that you meet that's seemingly different the way that people have treated you who called you different. Did you catch that? And so, but Jesus is not going to be stopped by man's differences because he's Lord of all. And he responds when the woman said, when he said, could you give me some water? And she said, no. Wait a minute. How is it that you being a Jew and I'm a Samaritan that you're having a conversation with me because everybody knows. So she's bringing in the social media part about what everybody knows. And you have to wonder, how does she know what everybody knows? But maybe there's a consensus in the community that, you know, it is us and them. And that we're going to stay on our lane, they've got to stay in their lane, and we'll get along just fine. But Jesus is the one that's going to cross up lanes and make one pathway. And that road will be a road of righteousness and holiness by faith. And so, sure enough, he says, if you knew who I was, you would ask me and I would give you living water. So she challenges him. Even though she needs living water, sometimes people, you know what people need, but they're not quite in a position with the right information to express that need. But we know the end of the story, that Jesus stayed steady with this lady. And he just peeled off the layers to get down to the heart of the matter. Go get your husband. I don't have a husband. You're right. You've had five. Now that opens by the Spirit of God her heart. So now she shifts. I perceive you are a prophet who is reading my mail. So let me get off of that subject and let's go to church. Let's just talk about church and the divisions in church. Our fathers worship in this mountain, but the Jews said you got to be in Jerusalem. So Jesus had to straighten all of that out. We know at the end of the story, she drops her buckets and she runs to the city and she preaches. And then the city comes out and said, we believe he's the Christ, not because you said it, but we heard him for ourselves. And isn't that our passion, that a people will say, I know him for myself now. Your faith may have aided me to come to faith, but our joy is the person to say, I have come to my faith. I know him now. What a testimony, Levi. Thank you. And as it was, that lady is still being preached everywhere. And because of her faith. Matthew chapter 15. And that, behold, a woman of Canaan came from that region and cried out to him, saying. Now, if you read Mark 7, it's going to tell you the same story, about 7 and 24. You don't have to turn there. But we find that Jesus came into that region, and now he's gone and entered into a house. And next thing that Mark will teach us, Mark 7, will teach us that he didn't want anyone to know he was there. Now, Matthew doesn't bring that out, but Mark's going to help him, right? Or help us. And so he doesn't really want to be there. So it appears that he's there for a time of maybe just refreshing or teaching of his disciples, or maybe he's there for one woman. It is amazing, and I've said it many, many times, that when God is dealing with you, he has a way of making you feel like he's, while he's working with everybody, he's with nobody but you. That's one of the great aspects of God being so God and so omniscient and so all-powerful and so ever-present, is that he can minister in Jerusalem and in Bell Fountain at the same time. And only God can do that. But listen to what she said. She came from that region and cried out to him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David." Now, here we have, and I'm going to use a word, a Gentile woman, a woman who is not under the old covenant of Israel, who has not had or come to understand the promises that have been released through Abraham that starts with Israel, then intended for the world. But she is using a title, Son of David, announcing her understanding that Jesus was the king. And so in that lordship, master and owner, and he announces him, Son of David. And she begins to make her statement by saying, "My daughter is severely demon-possessed." And I know you're familiar with this story, but I want you to see a little further, but he answered her not a word. Sometimes, you know, it's good to pause. And maybe the Lord was pausing, because you know a pause can say volumes. It gives you time to think, even when the person pausing may know exactly what they're doing. But a pause will cause you to think. Because if I was to say, "For God so loved," I just paused, but you finished it. Because it provoked you to think. And so, but he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she cries out after us." Now remember, Jesus is in the house. The lady makes her way somewhere in the area of the house, and she is sounding off like only a mother can with a child in need. I'm not taking away anything from the brothers, but you get a sister who knows her only help is in the Lord. She's got a cry that God attends to. You can find it all through the thread of the scriptures. But here this woman is not just saying, "Hey, Jesus, if you're not busy, could you help me?" Oh, no. Her cry came deep. Just like Hannah's cry went deep, and she cried after him, and she said, first of all, "O Lord, have mercy on me," and then gave him his proper title, "Thou Son of David," which means that she recognized the promise. She recognized that a king would come who could resolve all issues. But Mark tells us something else about this lady, because somewhere in Mark, it says that she had heard of him. Now, somebody's talking, and Jesus' fame and what he has done and the compassion that he has showed is coming into the ears of the Gentiles, and there's no need to say, hold up, now we can't let you hear it. But somehow this thing is getting over. And so somebody in the crowd when Jesus was preaching told somebody about his preach, and that preach got to her. It is just like it is the hope of my heart that the preacher mercy moves from you to somebody else. And so, but the disciples the brothers carrying the covenant and the promises of Abraham, is dull in response to her need. And the best thing to do in those cases is just send her away. Because after all, she came to see Jesus and not them. And she has that attitude. Now, you don't see it, but you know she does. She may not announce it, but you know she does. I did not. Now, if it was an American sister, she would have got the deacons and the ushers and everybody else. I'm not here to see you. So you see the determination and the passion revealed in the scripture because of her persistence. And maybe somebody heard that they preached that Jesus says there was an unjust judge in the land. And there was a woman who came to him and said, please give me justice because my adversary is pressing in on me. And so he didn't say nothing. Imagine that. But she kept on pressing. And then he said, even though I don't fear God, Gentile, and I don't fear man, I don't have no regard for them, but because of her continuing nagging, New Living Translation, according to Rick's, I'm going to go ahead and answer and give her her request, lest she wear me out with her constant and persistence. And he said, listen to what the unjust judge says. And will I not help his people who come to him? And so he's drawing that comparison. Well, I don't know what message somebody heard, but evidently she got the testimony that he heals people. And you can get a report that say this is the worst news in this case here, as no one has ever survived from it. Or you can have faith that comes by hearing. And something else this lady must have heard, no doubt, she's heard that he is merciful. So all of a sudden, she's also heard that he's the son of David. But something else is happening here. There's an interaction from heaven in this woman's life, in this woman's life, because even the Lord said, nobody can come to me unless my Father draw him or draw her. And so we got all of that within the text. And so she stands and she is desperate and she has passion and she has persistence and she knows what she wants. And she's not going back down, because if the disciples have it in their heart for her to go away, she didn't pay any attention to their mood. So evidently she gets closer to Jesus, or either Jesus comes out of the house. But he answered and said, I'm not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Okay. Now, if it was us, we could have said, but I didn't come over to your territory, you came to mine. Of course, she didn't say that. What she did, in spite of that, then she came and worshiped him. By the definition of the word, she prostrated herself down before the Lord. And she is a Gentile. But the Magi were Gentiles too. And they said, in their bowing down to Jesus, in their worship of Jesus, it's really the kind of the first time. We know the shepherds in the field went and they beheld him, but they came away praising and just glorifying God. But here we have the Magi bowing down first because they recognize he's a king. And so this woman recognizes that he is a king. That by chance, now the revelation has come that the Messiah to the Jews is also the Messiah to the whole world. Have mercy on me. To everybody. Now, this is something his disciples haven't even grasped. The sister is grasping this. Then she came and worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. Do you know the real God has never denied that? This is coming from her heart. And she uses, in the beginning, the code. And the code we know now is, Lord, have mercy on me. Because I have not found in Scripture anyone crying out that way from their heart has ever been denied. Because as I mentioned, it speaks to the fact that you're acknowledging that someone can help you when you can't help yourself. It speaks to the fact that you recognize a sovereign above yourself. It announces the fact that there is no pride in you, but humility is with you. Have mercy on me is speaking vertical, not lateral. Have mercy on me is a mercy encounter. And you're going to find mercy encounters in other places in the scripture. Where there's a blind man beside the road. It's a mercy meeting. He didn't know it was going to be mercy day for him. And when he heard, because he couldn't see it, when he heard that Jesus was coming by, he began to cry out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And when other people wanted him to shh, 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 he cried out even the more. In other words, in our turn, he got real loud. And sometime in conservative settings, it's not proper to be loud. Well, this man didn't go to that school because his need was deeper, so much deeper, because he had heard about Jesus. That Jesus was able to heal him. That Jesus was having mercy on people. And she said, Lord, help me. Do you feel the cry in those three words? Lord, help me. It's the testimony that I need help. I understand the song, I Need Thee. How I need thee. Every, not occasionally, every hour I need you, so that when you're in need, you recognize you need him. And after your need is met, you recognize that you need him. And because of the exposure to the need meter, you don't want to lose that for the rest of your days. Then she came and worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. Next verse. But he answered and said, I'm just glad he's answering me. Come on, let's just pause right there. I'm just glad that he's saying something. Because at first, he didn't say nothing. And that caused me to think. Now he's answering her twice, and it appears that he is putting up a little resistance, which makes her press in more. You know, when you don't have the end of your God-inspired request, press in. Let your faith say, he wants this. For him, he wants this. For his honor, he wants this. But he answered and said, it's not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And as I said Sunday, he's not insulting her, but the analogy. If you look at it from Gentile to Jew, from that perspective, then the Jew had been given the bread of life that came down from heaven. they're feeding, and this is targeted, you think, just to her, but he's teaching his disciples who wanted to push her away, but she used a code that Jesus wouldn't resist. And even though he seems to be pressing her, why would he do it? He's pressing her that faith that pleases God would come forth. He's setting her up so that the disciples would know, as the Apostle Paul said, that the Jews would be saved through faith and the Gentiles would be saved by faith. And so therefore, now he's pressing in, and look at her response. She's not pausing, even if there's an analogy, she's not pausing to be offended because she doesn't have offense in her heart anyway. She's got a need in her heart. And obviously she recognized what Jesus said, because watch this powerful answer. Next verse. And she said, yes, you're right. You're right. You are right. It is good to agree with God. You are right. Now, my sister at the well took a few steps, so that was us. But this, see, I paused to let you think. Because we go through a few steps. We're on our way to believing God, but you do well to just go ahead and believe him, because as at the end of your journey to believe him, you'll find out that you should have believed him in the first step. Just in the beginning. In other words, if he speaks to you, Mike, and said, don't you know I have you covered? And then when you go through the mental gymnastics later down the road and arrive to a moment of refreshing, and you look back and say, why did I, you fill in the blank, why did I try to figure it out and help God? Why did I have to send for Hagar? Why did I just believe him? Why did I laugh in my tent and tell the Lord I didn't laugh, and he had to correct you and say, oh, yes, you did. And yet, because you did laugh, it didn't stop him from his purpose. God was including them in his eternal plan, and so what they misstepped didn't stop him, so he extends mercy. You'll see it in the scripture, and he still fulfills the purpose that he had planned. Isn't that something that God blesses you in spite of you? And that's not a message of weakness. It is a message of his greatness. And he said, yes, Lord. She said, yes, Lord, I agree with you. Do you not know two cannot walk together? See, I just paused again. You finish it. Two can't walk together unless they agree. So let's look at this scripture. First of all, something has happened in heaven, and God is touching her heart and drawing her to mercy. Because she needs mercy. Because her baby is sick. And you combine passion and a need of mercy, and something is drawing you to where mercy is. The reason I said that Obed-Edom began to prosper and be blessed is because mercy had arrived into his house. And even as you experience, you know, the worship on Sunday, mercy had settled in. And when I heard the beauty of your singing and playing tonight, I saw this clothed with mercy. We stand in awe of you. And what a testimony to Jesus, and what a beauty in his ears that he has raised up a generation that understands that we are being sustained by his mercy. And so, we find that this woman answers in a powerful way and said, yes, Lord, I agree with you. Yet the little dogs, the pets under the table, eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. You listen to her faith, because she believes. She believes that a crumb from God is greater than the demon fighting her daughter. And you've heard me preach before. If there's vanilla in the cake, there's vanilla in the crumbs. And if God is in the cake, God is in a slice of the cake. And if you have a crumb or a slice, you have all God. whether it's crumb or loaf, it's all God. So it is, she almost using his own words in agreement. Yeah, but see, I recognize that you are the master. I recognize that the covenant belongs to the Jews. I recognize that. But you mentioned the little dogs. Okay, give me the crumb. Listen to the Lord's response. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is your, say it, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. And one translation says from that very moment, that when faith was engaged and Lord spoke the word, the healing happened. So we see here in this scripture, it begins off with what sustains us. And it is well said. I said this in earlier Bible study, and I said it. No, I don't know. I was sharing with some brother, and I was just sharing the fact that mercy is the only solution to the human experience. It's the only thing that helps. I'm talking about this, the human experience, this life. So let me help you with something about mercy. This is a correction, because mercy is sometimes thought of that it is related to you or given to you when you fall, when you are in a need beyond your ability to supply it yourself. But I'm going to tell you something. Mercy does not wait. See that pause? Say it with me. Mercy does not wait. And you said, does not wait for what? Mercy does not wait for you to fall. Mercy sustains you in your life. And if there is a problem, so if I asked the question on Sunday, and I say, anybody know they need mercy? You know, there were some people raised their hand, and other people said, well, you know, I don't have any trouble. As if mercy is only suited for trouble. Mercy is the key to your salvation, that out of mercy God saved you. Out of mercy God is sustaining you. In him you live, move, and have your being. That is all coming out of the mercies of God. And out of the mercies of God, according to the scripture, he saved us. It is out of his mercy that he keeps us. It's the only reason he's even dealing with mankind, because of the treasures of his mercy and including us in his desire to have us to be a part of his eternal plan beyond even your life in this earthly body. Because his plans extend into forever, so therefore it was necessary that mercy of the Lord would offer to you eternal life through believing in Jesus Christ. Because of the plan so far in front of us, he's not going to wait. He deals with us here so that we will have a guarantee in how to participate there. How many understand that? How many are looking at me like this? Nobody? Everybody got it? Everybody can teach it? Say it again? It was inspired, so I can't. No. Mercy, God sends forth through Jesus Christ out of the treasure of his tender mercy the provisions that we need to participate with him in forever. But he works with us now in this time as a guarantee that we'll be a part of his eternal plan. Now, I know, and I said this, that people say, you know, sometimes you say, God's got a plan for your life. God's got a plan for his life. The truth of the matter is God got a plan. Now he's including your life. You see the difference? God has a plan before I arrive to the plan. And it's according to his mercy that he included me in the plan. But his plan was holy before I was made holy. The plan was eternal before he gave me eternity. The plan was in his heart and in his mind before it was revealed to us. So now comes the prophets that announce the coming of the solution for the whole world. And then he appeared. And he preached the gospel of his kingdom, the authority and the rule. So when this woman shows up, she said, "Jesus, thou son of David. Oh, Lord, the son of David, the king of the universe, have mercy on me." And because of her persistence, and even when challenged, she pressed in and it revealed her faith, and that pleased God. And she got exactly what she wanted. Is that worthy of an amen? Did you get it? Yes? Anybody else? Question? Yes, sir. Faith is not faith until it's applied. So, the availability of mercy is everywhere. To tap into that mercy is different. So, it was done when the conditions of mercy were met. That's why he says, "I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy." Meet the conditions of mercy and the protocols of mercy, you get mercy. It is just like Jesus died for the whole world. Meet the protocols and you participate in what his death accomplished. So from that standpoint is that Jesus, remember, he's operating as God, but God's man filled with the Spirit of the Lord, a man filled with the Spirit of the Lord. And therefore, the protocols of faith were met, and they were exercised by the woman, and that pleased God. So then the domino effect took place. Yeah. Yeah, her walk from wherever she was a faith walk. Crossing the line to find Jesus, and she's a Gentile, is speaking to her faith. And so she is exercising and dealing with faith as she knows it, and now she's going to meet Jesus and cry after him. And obviously, as I said, he must have came outside. Because she went in the house, because I don't know how persistent she was. She may have went in the house, and the disciples could have been at the door all like this. And then she just said, "Excuse me. I want to talk to him." Anybody who seeks him after that way will get an audience. And to give a full answer to your question, when faith was exercised, mercy came. Now, I think what you were asking me, because she said, "Oh, Lord, have mercy on me," that code alone activated the mercy that will follow. And that is true. Okay? Whether she's Jew or Gentile, it doesn't matter. Her cry, that activated that. But Jesus wanted something more than just her daughter being healed. And so he presses in and to get faith out of this lady based on what she has heard and what she believed, because faith, after her daughter is healed, her faith will keep her for the rest of her life. So her Gentiles are saved by faith? Okay, good question. We're going to close out for tonight, and I want you to continue to seek the Lord. And remember, as I said, I don't know if I put it that way, but mercy is the only remedy to the human experience. Amen? Come on, stand with me. Father, we love you and thank you so much, Lord God, for our brother's testimony, for Brother Levi, for the richness of faith in your people. Lord God, for you unfolding your plan. And we thank you, Lord God, that you are God and we are your servants. In Jesus' name, thank you for your tender mercies. And everyone say amen. Amen.